My hallelujah belongs to you. Oh, my hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it, Jesus. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. My hallelujah belongs to you. Oh, my hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. Jesus, my hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. Father, you deserve it. You deserve our praise. You deserve our love. You deserve everything, everything. Father, you're so amazing. You're so beautiful. You're so kind. Thank you for life and life abundantly. Thank you for good health. Thank you for provision. Thank you for protection. Thank you for your divine favor that only you can give. Father, may our lives always continually reflect your glory in the name of Jesus. Help us to live and pursue righteousness and holiness and everything that you're about in the name of Jesus. Above all, help us to be patient while you're working everything out for our good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hello, beautiful God girls. This is Pastor Bella, and welcome to part 8 of Supernatural Marriage. God is awesome. I'm still in awe that we are here doing part 8, and we hadn't gone into the couple of study that the Lord wanted us to learn a lot from concerning supernatural marriage. God is amazing. Just yield to Him. Whatever He places on your heart, just seek direction from Him. You know, when He has called you to do something, spend time with Him so that you can understand how to do it right. Go on a fast for clarity, for direction, because when you do things hand in hand with God and He has called you to do that thing, you cannot fail. You have to learn to wait upon Him. You have to learn to walk with Him, not ahead of Him, not behind Him. Walk with Him, partner with Him in prayer, understand him by reading his word. Spend time with him. There is a way that God seeks to communicate with you. So understand the primary way he communicates with you. It can be through dreams. It can be through his voice. Understand him. Ask for clarity. The Lord is amazing. So today we're going to talk about different things, but of course we're going back to the beginning because Adam and Eve, they were the first supernatural marriage, and there's so many things to learn from them. One of the things that you need to learn from them is, I've spoken to, you know, especially singles. Singles have this naive thing that if God has ordained someone as your spouse, everything is just going to work out fine. And I'm here to tell you that it's not always that way. Adam and Eve were the first man and woman in the world. They were given the first marriage. They had the first intimate relationship with God. They were placed in a perfect setting, the Garden of Eden. They were placed in perfection. They were perfectly made for each other. And yet, failure happened to them. They still remain married, but they fell out of favor with the Lord. They lost their Eden. So when God gives you your ordained spouse, you can still mess it up. You can still mess things up, or your spouse can. It takes the two of you to work hard at your marriage, to keep God as the primary focus of your marriage. Marriage is a responsibility. It's not for children. You need to have that maturity to handle marriage. It's not about you anymore. It's about you and another person. And the two of you are now going to bring life into the world. You're going to bring children into the world. And when you have children, children come to you very dependent. They don't know anything. They're looking to you for direction. So if you're already not someone that knows how to set a good example in life, set a good example as a father or as a mother, as a husband or as a wife, how on earth are you going to set a good example for your children? Marriage is a responsibility. Again, I keep saying supernatural marriage is a reward. Let's go to our key scripture. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 to 12. Two are better than one. Weren't Adam and Eve two? They were two. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. When Eve fell, Adam was right next to her. When she took a bite out of that fruit, Adam did not step in to stop her and intercede. And you get what I'm saying? He went along and ate the fruit with her. So two of them can fall. Mm-hmm. So you need to understand that, yes, God has given us the gift. He has given us the promise, but you can ruin it. You can ruin this promise in a heartbeat. You can ruin it. If you don't stay close to God, if you don't lean on God, if your spouse doesn't stay close to God, if he doesn't lean on God, there's going to be major trouble in your Eden. So let's not be naive. Some of you are expecting Mr. Perfect to walk into your life, Mr. Oh-So-Godly Man. Well, Mr. Oh-So-Godly Man is flesh and spirit. He's a human being. Okay? He's a human being. And no matter how godly he is a human being. And human beings make mistakes. That's why when I was teaching you about King David, I said, King David was a godly man, right? But he still fell into adultery. Some of you have that inclination that, well, since he's a godly man, he's above sexual sin. Let me clear something here with you. None of us are above sin. We are standing here today by the grace of God. If you don't work on your spiritual maturity, if you don't work on your praying life, if you don't work on your word life, you can fall. You can fall into any kind of sin. If you're not careful the kind of people you place around you, you can fall into any kind of sin. So when you get married to your godly spouse, you're not supposed to relax and say, yeah, I got a godly spouse, so there's some things that will just never, never happen. You better be a praying woman. You better be a praying man. You better put a hedge of protection, daily hedge of protection, over your marriage. Because just as the serpent was in Eden, the serpent is alive today and he is coming for you. He is coming to attack your marriage from every side. And the two of you have to be a praying people. Supernatural marriage is so beautiful, totally orchestrated by God. But the two of you still have a responsibility to maintain it. So I want to point out some things from Genesis. Let's go into the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 2. Okay. So, Genesis chapter 2 verse 8. First of all, let me start from 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. God, girls, your supernatural husband needs to have the breath of life, the breath of God upon him. He needs to carry the Spirit of God within him. He needs to be a godly man, a man that loves God and fears God. If not, as a daughter of God, he is no good for you. Verse 8, the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground, the Lord God made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God planted Adam in Eden. God planted Adam in his assignment. Let's go to verse 15. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. Your supernatural husband, when he comes into your life, he's not going to be aimless. He needs to be a man operating in his assignment. Some people will tell you he needs to have a job. That's what they mean. He needs to be working. That's what they mean, right? Because a man is supposed to be a provider, right? But beyond just having a job, beyond just working, has he found himself in God? Is he cultivating the assignment that the Lord has called him to? Because if not, he is not ready for you. He needs to have found himself in God. He needs to have found his purpose in God. He needs to have been wired a certain way. When you ask him questions about the purpose of his life, what he feels he was put on this earth for, what is his area of expertise? What is his area of calling? What is that burden that the Lord has placed upon his heart? That is his assignment. He needs to be working in his assignment. He can't just be sitting down, loafing around, not sure of where he's going, not sure of what he's doing. So it's beyond just financial. Some of you have your eyes open for a rich and established man. He may not have much money. He may not have much money. But if he is a man driven by purpose, a man of vision, a man that the Lord has called in a certain area, and he is working that area and being a good steward of it, that's a very good sign. Because Adam was a steward of the Garden of Eden. Adam was working. He was taking care of everything. And the Lord gives Adam an instruction, verse 16. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, "Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." The man needs to understand his assignment. He needs to live a life that is in obedience to God, because God has given him instructions about his assignment, and he needs to have already been living that way. He needs to be a man of discipline, because how can he lead you? How can he cherish you if he has not learned to be obedient to God? As Adam was taking care of everything capably, the Lord said to himself in verse 18, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make a helper comparable to him." The first man in the world created, a man created in the likeness and image of God. God looked at Adam very well and said, "I will make him a helper comparable to him." Comparable to him. God is not just going to give you any wishy-washy person and say that's your ordained spouse. Your Adam must be in purpose. He must be established in having that confidence of who he is and what he has been placed on this earth for. He should be a man in his area of expertise. He should be a man in his assignment before you come along. Because you don't want to be the one leading him. He has to lead you. He was created first, not the woman. You understand? He was the one, sorry, let me use the word. He was the one formed first. Male and female were spoken forth on the same day. But Adam was formed first. Eve was still within Adam. But he was formed first. And for Eve to still be within Adam, Adam is, what is the word I'm looking for? He's already an established visionary. A leader needs to be a visionary. You're carrying something huge within you. You're carrying a huge vision within you. You're carrying responsibility within you. He's carrying Eve within him, carrying another human being within him. So if he doesn't know who he is, how on earth is he going to birth that vision and bring that vision alive? How on earth? All right. Verse 19, "Out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them." God brought them to Adam. God will bring the assignment to Adam. God will be relating with Adam and letting him know, this is how to serve me in the area that I have called to you. And Adam, in obedience, will do it. And Adam will also learn to be a leader. You think it's easy to get up and be naming every living creature? God could have done it for Adam, but God didn't. God humbly brought the animals to Adam. So we learn two things here. First of all, as a leader, you must be humble. God himself is humble. God gave Adam responsibility to name the animals. God could have done it himself. He was the same God that created everything in 6 days. So he could have as well named the animals. But no, he gave Adam an assignment. So your ordained husband needs to be thriving in his assignment, and it's beyond just how much money is in his account. Some of you are so focused on how financially established a man is that you're forgetting that there is more to a man than his finances. Is he a visionary? Is he filled with the love and fear of God? Is he on fire for God? Does he know his area of calling? Is he thriving in that area of calling? You want a man who is fulfilling purpose. Beyond everything else will come. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. You need to see in the man that this man's heart is after God. Finances will come. It will come. Verse 20, so Adam gave names to all cattle, to the birds of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper comparable to him. Of course not. Those were animals. Those were animals. How could they be comparable for Adam? So what did the Lord do? The Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept, and he took one of Adam's ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. The first major surgery in the Bible had to do with marriage. Marriage is such a deep mystery. It's such a deep mystery. Here is a process. I mean, you're just reading two verses and it seems like it happened all at once. Verse 21, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep. It wasn't regular sleep. Deep sleep. When you go into surgery today, they're going to give you an anesthesia to knock you out. You're unconscious. Because if you're conscious while that surgery is performed, you're going to be in major pain. And there are different levels of it. Like if you're having a C-section, they'll just numb the area of surgery. They'll make sure that you're actually awake. But that area of surgery where they pull the baby out from, that place is numb. But Adam was totally put to sleep because the Lord was birthing that vision in Adam, was birthing that part of Adam that Adam truly needed, a companion, a lover, a friend, the one who would actually multiply on the earth and birth children and bring women in, and bring children into being, a powerful creature that was already a part of Adam, who was within Adam. But the Lord had to physically manifest her. God took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. That is a process. When the Lord is taking his rib out and he is in a deep sleep. Oh, Father, thank you. In the Songs of Solomon, you keep hearing them saying, don't awaken love until it's time. Some of you, the Lord has revealed your ordained husband to you. But you got to be careful. Because this may be the time he is in that deep sleep where the Lord is working on him. And you are being manifested. You don't want to try and get close to him now when he's in that deep sleep. The two of you are right for each other, but it's not yet time for the two of you to be together. So what do? You rest in God. You let God build you. Let God build you to be that helper that is comparable to Adam, to your man, to your ordained husband. Let God build you to be that helper that is comparable to him. So you're not focused on Adam if you already know who he is. You're focused on God so God can build you to be that helper that is comparable to him. This man carries vision. This man carries purpose. This man carries a godly assignment. Are you ready? Are you ready to be the wife to such a person? Physically, you think you're ready, but are you ready? Are you ready? Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they agree? Are you ready? Some of you want to be married to pastors. Do you know what it takes to be married to a pastor? Do you have that inner component to be married to a pastor? A pastor does not belong to you alone. The pastor belongs to the sheep. You have to be a woman of generosity. You have to be a woman who's secure in herself. You cannot be jealous that he's out there ministering to people. You cannot be jealous When women call him up for counseling, yes, as a married couple, you're going to put your boundaries, but you cannot be jealous and going crazy that he's out there serving the Lord in his assignment. Are you a helper comparable to him? Are you a helper comparable to your ordained husband? Because he has an assignment on his life. And if you are truly his rib, if you are truly the one that is a part of him, you should be able to recognize it and let that man be. You need to be comparable and support him in prayer, support him in his dreams, support him in his visions. And he also has to be supportive of you because you are a part of him. Verse 22, then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. God brought her to the man. God will bring you to your husband. You just need to wait for the Lord to build you. Some of you are so tired of your single season, but you're looking at your single season the wrong way. The Lord is building you to be a helper comparable to the man that he has ordained for you. He has an assignment on his life. And some of you, he may be fully established. He may be fully established in his assignment. Are you capable? Are you ready to be his queen? Let's go to the book of Esther. Oh, the Bible is so interesting. So we're going from Genesis 2 to Esther chapter 2. Esther chapter 2. You know of King Ahasuerus. Look at how the Bible introduced us to this man. He was a king. He was rich. He was wealthy. He was assured of himself. He was ruling a great nation. He was just full of opulence and wealth and establishment and confidence. Are you a helper comparable to your king? A man that is established, strongly established in the area that God has called him to? Again, I'm going to use ministry because ministry is my life. You're a single God girl. And the man God is preparing you for, he's the pastor of a huge, huge following. He has a lot of sheep. He has thousands of sheep. He is established in ministry. What about you? What is your praying life like? What is your word life like? What is your spiritual maturity level? Are you ready? Are you ready to be the wife that stands by him? Are you ready? Have you allowed the Lord to build you and put you in the presence of such a man that is established in his calling? He's not just starting out now. I've given you the example of the one that's just starting out. No, this one is established. He is successful. He is, all he needs right now is a helper comparable to him. Are you letting the Lord build you in your single season for your king? Because Esther got a king. She got an established king. She didn't get a child king. She got a king that had been sitting on his throne, already had a queen, and displaced her because that queen was just out of order. This was a full-grown man and a full-grown king. Esther let the Lord build her. Esther chapter 2. Don't despise your single season. Because the man God is building you for, you need to be a helper comparable to him. Not someone that will come into his life and destroy what the Lord has called him to. You are a woman of influence. How on earth did Eve get Adam to eat that apple? Adam, who had been walking with God way before Eve was manifested. Adam, who had such a strong relationship with God way before Eve was manifested. He saw that woman and lost his head. Standing right next to her, he didn't step up as a man. She was in clear disobedience to the instruction that the Lord had given to him. When God calls you for your assignment, he's going to set the rules for you. And you're to abide by those rules. Sometimes they're called rules of consecration to your calling. When you look at Samson, Samson's parents were instructed that they should never cut his hair. There are certain rules to your anointing and your calling. And you have to abide by them. If not, you will lose everything. And whoever you're getting married to must respect that and abide by it. Eve was created as a helper comparable to Adam. But when she presented that fruit to Adam, Adam didn't even just discard it. He took it and ate it and lost everything. A woman has so much influence. A wife has so much influence over her husband. If you don't have that spiritual maturity, if you have not let the Lord build you, you're going to end up being Jezebel in your marriage. Because guess what? Jezebel had a lot of influence over Ahab, but her influence was of evil and not of good. What kind of helper are you? Are you a helper comparable to the man God has ordained for you? Or are you a helper helping him towards hell? Let the Lord build you in your single season. Do not despise your single season. God is going to make everything beautiful in his time. This is the time to draw close to God. Because the Lord knows who he is preparing you for. And supernatural marriage is an extraordinary marriage that has purpose from the beginning. God is bringing the two of you for a kingdom purpose. And there is no delay to it. That's why the courtship is so quick. It's not taking forever. It's so quick because the Lord has a work that the two of you need to do for him before the return of the king. Because guess what? That's the overall supernatural marriage. Being the bride, body, and church of Christ. Who is Christ coming back for with the rapture? He is coming back for his own. He is coming back for his bride. So supernatural marriage is quick. Because the Lord has determined that it is not good for a man to be alone. The Lord has trained your ordained husband in his assignment, in his single season, and the Lord is now putting him to sleep in order to manifest you and birth you. And then, in that due process, while the Lord is preparing you for him, submit to the Lord. Submit to the Lord's knowledge and wisdom. Don't just be crying and crying, "Where's my husband?" Use that season to learn and let the Lord build you. Because what if you're like Esther, you're given a king from the onset? What if you're given the president of a nation? What if you're given someone who is so out there and so popular as a public figure? What are you gonna do? Are you comparable? Are you able to handle it? It's a lot of responsibility alone. Marriage is a lot of responsibility alone in private. But when you're pushed out into the public eye, it's a whole lot more, a whole lot more. Esther chapter 2. So it was when the king's command and decree were heard, and when many young women were gathered at Shusha in the citadel under the custody of Haggai, that Esther also was taken to the king's palace into the care of Haggai, the custodian of the women. Now the young woman pleased him, and she obtained his favor. So he readily gave beauty preparations to her besides her allowance. Then 7 choice maidservants were provided for her from the king's palace, and he moved her and her maidservants to the best place in the house of the women. Why? Why did he do all this for Esther? Because Esther was humble. She submitted to him. She was kind to him. She was gracious to him. Single God girl, are you letting the Lord build you? What is your character like? You think the favor of God just comes upon someone who's behaving in a messed up way? The favor that came upon Esther also shows that Esther was humbly submitted to God. And I'm telling you, if you are humbly submitted to God, submitting to your godly husband will not be a problem. Esther was very submissive. How do I know that? She submitted to the eunuch here. She's submissive to Mordecai. Even after she had attained the position of queen, she was still submissive to Mordecai. She didn't say, "I'm queen now. You don't know anything. I'm the king's wife, so shush." No, she didn't do that. She was still submissive and humble. And when humility is a part of your character, you will go far with God. And that's why Esther went far in the palace. They loved her because she followed instruction. She was humble. Verse 12, each young woman's turn came to go into King Ahasuerus after she had completed 12 months preparation. 12 months preparation, according to the regulations for the women, for thus were the days of their preparation apportioned, 6 months with oil of myrrh and 6 months with perfumes and preparations for beautifying women. Thus prepared, each young woman went to the king, and she was given whatever she desired to take with her from the women's quarters to the king's palace. 12 months of preparation. 12 months of preparation to meet with the king. In order for you to become the selected queen. How many women did King Ahasuerus see? A lot of them. A lot of them. You spend one night with him and that's it. That's it. And if he doesn't want you anymore, that's it. He's done with you. He's looking for his queen. But look at how long each woman had to prepare. But because the favor of God was upon Esther, the favor of God was upon Esther. God, girl, if you are submissive to God in your single season and you do what the Lord has laid on your heart to do and you are faithful to God, his favor will be upon you. If you are parents, you will understand what I'm saying. When your children are obedient to you, they carry your favor. You will do anything for them because they're obedient. They're submissive to you. They don't give you any trouble. That's how it is with God. You want his favor. You need to behave right. You need to behave right. Verse 15. Now when the turn came for Esther, the daughter of Abihail, the uncle of Mordecai, who had taken her as his daughter to go in to the king, she requested nothing but what Haggai, the king's eunuch, the custodian of the women, advised. You see that? What they advised. She was still humbly submissive to that eunuch, and she was very wise because the eunuch had seen a lot of women come and go. The eunuch was the one in charge of all the king's women, his harem. That is someone you should lean on. That was a mentor in Esther's life. You have to be submissive to your mentor in your preparation season. God is going to give you certain people in your preparation season. You better be submissive and don't think you know better than them. You better not be stubborn. You better not hear counseling and reject it. If you're not teachable, you're just slowing the process down. So some of you that have been waiting on God forever, you need to search yourself. As you've been waiting on God forever for your godly husband, how is your character? How is your submission to God? You may be the delay in your path because you refuse to learn the lesson that the Lord is teaching you. You want to be a helper comparable to your king? You need to submit to the Lord. You need to submit to the King of Kings and let him show you how to be the queen to a king. Let him show you how to be a wife to a king. Because Queen Vashti mixed the roles. She disrespected the office of the king. She was too familiar with the king as her husband, so she just rejected her husband. But by rejecting her husband, she rejected the king. She rejected the office. You need to be able to know the office your husband occupies. You need to respect his office. You also need to respect him as your husband. That man that is intimate with you, that man that comes off his throne out there and comes home to play with you, have sex with you, you still need to respect him. And don't be over familiar like Vashti was. That's how Vashti lost her position. Because she disrespected both the man and his office. Are you allowing the Lord to build you as a helper comparable to your man, to your king, to your Adam? Oh, Father, we thank you. And Esther obtained favor in the sight of all who saw her. How would she not obtain favor when she's so submissive and so humble? God, girls, you have to be submissive. You have to be submissive to the process the Lord will take you to in your single season because he's teaching you how to be a submissive wife. If you don't know how to submit to God, you will not know how to be a submissive wife. So you need to work on your spiritual life and trust that the Lord is working on your ordained husband. Because that man, Adam, was alone with God before Eve was manifested. Your husband, your godly supernatural husband, is alone with God now. The Lord is teaching him things. The Lord is building him for you. And you, the Lord is also building you for him. It just depends on where the process is. If he is now in that sleeping process and the Lord is building you and building you, soon it will be the time of manifestation because Adam woke up and the Lord brought Eve to him. The Lord brought his wife to him. The Lord will bring you into the presence of your husband. The Lord brought Esther into the presence of King Ahasuerus, but she didn't just come off the streets to meet King Ahasuerus. She had spent 12 months of preparation to meet with King Ahasuerus. So your single season is not for complaints. Your single season is not for fornication because you can't control your sexual desire. You're tired of being alone, so you're going out there sleeping with every man. That's not what your single season is for. It is for preparation to be a helper comparable to the husband the Lord has prepared for you. And the same thing goes for the men. Your single season, you better be alone with God. You're looking for that supernatural wife, supernatural marriage that the Lord has promised in this season. Y'all better stay alone with God and be in obedience to God so you don't mess up. You don't tear apart what the Lord is ordaining and putting together two of his children. You need to have that spiritual maturity and capability to handle the blessing of supernatural marriage, which is a reward. All right, God girls, God loves you and I love you. This is Pastor Bella, the ultimate God girl. God bless you.